This is Dan Sweeney, the director of the Institute for Enterprise Ethics at the Daniels College of Business here on the University of Denver campus. This edition of Ethically Speaking deals with the lessons we might learn from the corporate ethics scandals of last year, 2015. It is based on a panel discussion hosted by the Institute on February 18, 2016. The discussion was led by my podcast partner, Paul Gibbons. 2015 produced some of the most glaring and atrocious violations of enterprise ethics principles since Enron, WorldCom, and HealthSouth were manipulating their financial results. Bribery by FIFA officials, deception by VW executives, price gouging by pharmaceutical companies, and LIBOR rate manipulation by employees at numerous banks. Surely these scandals hide some important lessons for the rest of the business community. What went wrong, and what lessons can we learn from these corporate fiascos? Paul, we just finished quite an interesting discussion with quite a large audience, examining some of the lessons we might take away from the egregious corporate scandals of 2015. What struck you as some of the more interesting learnings that came up this morning for businesses that would like to avoid such scandalous behavior in the future?
Well, Dan, thanks. One of the things I think is most interesting is that ethical issues don't just go away. They don't happen every decade, they happen every year. And our discussion about which were the worst for 2015, there were another half dozen names we could have picked. We could have picked, for example, price gouging and increasing the price of a drug by 750% when that was a life-saving drug. But we chose these three, and I think there are some common themes that came out. The one that strikes me that's a common to FIFA, to LIBOR, and to Volkswagen is whistleblowing. And where if the scandal touched 11 million cars, and teams of engineers who created the defeat device that was used to suppress emissions, who had to know and why did they say nothing about it? Now, similarly with FIFA, that had been in the press for a very long time, since the middle of the last decade, but how did that manage to stay out of the widespread public eye for a decade? And similarly with LIBOR, this is a practice that has been going on perhaps for as many as 20 years, and perhaps for even longer than that. And so again, with 150 rate fixings a day in a bank, and 14 or 16 banks involved in setting the London Interbank Offered Rate, LIBOR rate. How did that evade the attention of the people and the organizations that are sitting next to the people who are carrying out these malfeasance? Because it's impossible to believe that they didn't know. So if they did know, why didn't they say? And if they did say, why weren't they listened to? And if they were listened to, then why was nothing done at a senior and a board level? And so that for me is the whistleblowing, that chain of questions about whistleblowing is a common theme. One of our wonderful panelists, Bud Belanich, also talked about the shared responsibility that businesses have both for shareholder value and financial returns and serving the communities in which they exist, but also they depend upon for survival. And Bud said, and this is borne out by research, that it's in the long-term commercial interests of companies to also think hard about how they serve the communities, or in this case, how they do not abuse the communities. First, do no harm. Do not abuse the communities in which you serve. So Bud's point was extremely well taken. And I think the last point was raised by our legal specialist, Professor Claw, who said something that I think everyone should pay attention to is we want companies to do more than the law requires and less than it allows. And I just want to underline that point. Is our total of our responsibilities as ethical businesses or as ethical citizens are not described by the law. We have to do more than that. And so I think Bruce's point was very well taken.
Paul, one of the most common enabling factors that came up in all three examples this morning was the impact that corporate culture had on these companies' behavior. What can an executive team do to make corporate culture a force for positive behavior rather than an enabler of malfeasance?
Well, it's impossible to underestimate the importance of culture in these circumstances. When I investigated a rather small bank fraud by today's standards, $200 million at National Westminster Bank in England, they had controls in the middle office, in the back office, and in the front office. They had internal auditors. They had internal compliance. They had middle management oversight, board oversight, and executive level oversight. Then they had external auditors, the controller of the currency. Somebody was looking at the hen house, but still, no matter how well guarded the hen house was, the fox got in. So it's my view, and I wrote an article to this effect back almost 20 years ago, you cannot build a good enough mousetrap. Human beings are very smart. So if that's the case, and I think and that's widely accepted, then how do you create the right kind of culture? And it's obviously a huge question, but it certainly begins with the sorts of people you hire. And it certainly begins with, of course, education and whether there's ethics education as part of your onboarding. And I know that the best organizations in the world do have week-long programs to onboard people, and not just about finding out where the bathrooms are, where the cafeteria are, and how to turn on your computer, but also what are the ethical values that we're committed to and what we expect of you as employees. So the best companies do that. Make sure that we're not incentivizing the mice to get around the mouse trap. And in the case of the LIBOR scandal, one of the gentlemen who's spending 11 years in jail, but the only person who's not doing any significant jail time as a result, I might add, made $5 million in his first 9 months at Citibank. And his incentives were constructed such that it was purely in his financial interest to rig the system in his favor. And so if we want to have the right culture, we can't necessarily incentivize ethical behavior, but we want to make sure that our incentives don't run against the ethical standards and the ethical conduct we want.
Good points. Paul, another factor that came up frequently, especially in the cases of Volkswagen and FIFA, was the impact of weak governance overseeing the behavior of an organization. What is the responsibility of the board of directors in protecting the company from such scandalous behavior?
Well, Dan, we did talk about mice, and now we're going to go back to mouse traps and what are the structures that need to be created. So we've talked about how culture is underemphasized and how people think a new role or a new structure or a new process or a chief ethics officer are going to magically solve ethics problems, and we need it to be much deeper and wider than that into the culture. But now we're going to talk about the board, and what is interesting is just how poor board governance was. And so there are two things I think that came up that were interesting. One, the board of Volkswagen has no independent directors, nor does FIFA. And what's interesting there is that the board is composed of union representatives, representatives of the state, representatives of Catter, who owns a large percentage of Volkswagen, and there's only one management representative on the board, and then two old German families who are substantially wealthy and are entitled to seats on the board. So there we have a collection of people that wouldn't pass the tests in many countries, particularly this one, of professional business directors. And the second question is what questions the board are permitted to or willing to ask. There, of course, for financial governance, to what extent does their remit extend into the domain of ethics? Do they have permission to ask ethical questions of managers? And I think you and I would both agree on this, we've discussed it many times, is that unless they have permission, unless they have oversight of ethics, and you could say they're the custodians or the stewards of the ethical culture of the company, and that it needs to start at the very top. So there's no question that independent directors, mandatory term limits or rotation of directors, you know, we've talked extensively between you and I between the role of the chairman and the role of the chief executive. In Europe, it's very important they're separate because the chairman is a check on the chief executive. He's in charge of reward and development and coaching and oversight of the chief executive and his function in running the company. And we think that's very important in Europe. I think it's something where perhaps you might say that Europe are slightly further along because it's a mandatory legal requirement in the UK that they be separate individuals. So there's no question that as we move into the third decade of this millennium, that's one thing for certain, is that global governance, the governance of the institutions that matter most to us, the number one car maker, the number one sporting organization in the world, the most important interest rate in the world, that we need to make more attention to the people at the top.
Good observations. Thanks. Paul, I know, because we've talked about it a number of times, that you spent a good part of your career in the LIBOR world in the 1980s. What was the environment in those trading markets that allowed traders to think that rigging those rates was not a bad thing to do?
Well, in the 1980s, and I think investment banking and trading culture almost exactly the same as it was 30 years ago, there's only one thing that matters, is wealth. And so one of the traders who was, in fact, acquitted, he was a bond broker, said that I can't drink enough Penfold Grange and buy enough Gucci loafers. That's $700 bottle of wine and $600 shoes. And really, that's a symbol of how we think about the value of a person. I know that sounds highfalutin, something like that, but wealth really matters more than anything else. And so with that as a backdrop, how much money someone makes and how much they display is the most important feature of the organizations, and it's represented by the culture. And so what you see in investment banks is, of course, people having highly leveraged rewards which reinforce the culture I've just talked about, which is wealth is the most important thing. And they're not rewarded for anything, first of all, other than their P&L. They're not rewarded for behavior. They're not rewarded for developing people. They're not rewarded for ethical conduct. So the reward systems are incentives for them to make as much money as possible. There's no money. There's no free lunch. There are no free lunches. There's no big earnings individually and for the bank without them taking a lot of risk. So we encourage risk taking. And that's very much part of the culture. And it's also a gambling culture. You know, one of the things that when traders, go to the pub together and sit around and drink and recount the great stories of our day, they play gambling games in the pub. And one of my friends from those days, Michael Lewis, wrote a famous book about liar's poker, where they took out $100 bills and played liar's poker for $1 million. And so gambling is also very much part of the culture. And I don't have any moral objections to gambling when it's with one's own money. But of course, they're not gambling with just their own money. They're gambling not just with the bank's money, but as we saw in 2002, 2007, 2008, they're gambling with the incomes of the poor fellows on Main Street, whose income was affected by the meltdown, which was caused by the malfeasance on Wall Street. So it's not just their money. The importance of the banking system is so far-reaching that it reaches into the pockets of every person in the country. And so we have this culture which has, in my day certainly, contempt for ethics and contempt for anything that's seen as corporate, human resources, or any kind of formalism. So it's very much a culture of cowboys. I think it has improved, and it's much more professional than it once was, but certainly culture is the kind of thing that takes generations to change. Very much, I think, that a culture that affected everyone, not just in the United States, but in the rest of the world during 2007, 2008.
Do you think that that kind of culture is unique to these big financial services and banking organizations?
It was Enron was famously similar. It had a very famous sort of investment banking-like culture. But yes, I do think it is a disease that's particularly rampant on Wall Street. The people who I first worked with, who are commodity traders and interbank traders and money market traders, were all people who, as career earlier, had been working in the markets of East London selling fruits and vegetables and things. The sort of culture was very much rough and ready, very smart on my feet, quick thinking. I mean, they were very clever people, but certainly they wouldn't pass the test of anything like a professional attitude, an attitude of stewardship, a responsibility in one's community, a responsibility to the bank and to employees. And, you know, there was a lot of sexual and racial abuse. It was a cult, very vulgar culture. I don't object particularly to swearing. I think that happens every second word, and I don't object to that. But alongside that were the kind of torrent of, in my day, particularly racial and gender abuse, the sort of which wouldn't be tolerated today. You'd be fired instantly for the sorts of things that we say. But that kind of cowboy culture is certainly part of, I think, the problem that we see. But I do think banks are special in this regard, with the exception, the only exception I can think of is Enron.
I think that's a fairly common perception as well. That's why I asked the question. Good, thanks. Appreciate your perspective on that.
My pleasure, Dan.